fire of the Holy Ghost
to be upon your life this morning. In the name of Jesus, I am believing for somebody to catch on fire. Oh, hallelujah. That's been my prayer. That's been my contention. God,
set me on fire for you, oh God. Regardless of my situation and my circumstances.
Amen. Now we're up to the point to where we're going to have Pastor Dr. Antoine Butler.
Yes, Lord. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Come on, give it up as he comes. Amen.
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 Amen. Come on, can we give Jesus just one more hand of praise this afternoon, this evening? Amen. Amen. I thank God for being here today, and thank God for the two speakers who come before me. Amen. And I certainly want to thank God for Pastor Webb, co-Pastor Webb. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. I'm truly humbled to be in this space, in this place. And I think I did hear the woman of God say that this conference was put on your heart by the Holy Spirit. And so I just thank God for your obedience this evening. And I'm super excited to minister the word of God. I want to thank God for my wife who's in the back really quickly. Minister Breezer, thank you for being here. Amen. Hallelujah. Listen, so you all can be seated. I want to get straight into the word of God in the 15 minutes that I have. So by nature, by divine call, I'm a teacher. And so the information that I share today, it probably would benefit you best if you were to take some notes.
Yes, sir.
God didn't send me anywhere just as a place to preach. Anytime that I do come, it's because he wants to change someone's life.
Yes, sir.
I was supposed to be dead a long time ago.
Yes.
And so I know if I get an opportunity just to help somebody, it was possibly in the situation that I was in.
Yes, sir.
And so when I saw the word of God for this conference, Deuteronomy 4:23-24, my soul was already on fire.
Amen.
And so the scripture's already been read a couple of times, but I did want to bring attention to the first verse, and I want to start my discourse and conversation there because I think it's powerful.
Yes, sir.
In particular, what God is teaching us here.
Yes, sir.
Out of this text,
he says
that there is a responsibility here.
Yes.
Take heed. To ourselves. It's so easy to point our fingers at other people. All the things that we got going on in this community, our city, so easy to point our fingers and say it's the government, it's politics, it's my husband, it's my wife, right? But look at the admonition here. God said, no. Look in the mirror and see if you still in the faith. See if you're taking the responsibility upon yourselves. Now listen what he says. Here's the charge. Here's the charge.
Hey.
And I want to say this today because it's so easy to do this if you live in this country.
Yes, sir.
For those of you all who've been outside of this country, you understand what it means to be an American.
Yes.
Like here you can turn your water on, something come out.
Right.
You got multiple changes of clothes. You hit a light switch and your electricity comes on.
Yeah.
That's not true for about 75% of the world.
Right.
So here in this country, we can easily forget.
Right.
You know, this is the only place that you can drive to go get your food stamp card of a Cadillac. Mm-hmm. Like, you can't go no other place and do that. So if we're not careful in this country, we'll be playing church. Like, if we're not careful, we have this pseudo-religion where Jesus is nowhere in it. And so I love the word of God because it is always living.
Yes, sir.
And so we can look at the scripture and God can speak to our hearts.
Yes, sir.
So he says to the church, and it's our admonition today, he says, I don't want you to forget the covenant of the Lord, your God, which he made with you.
Yes, sir.
And then it goes down to the last verse and the reason for the conference. It says, because our God is a consuming fire.
Yes, sir.
I want to talk about that word covenant really quickly because the reason that we're here is because God has entered into a covenant with you and I.
That's right.
Fortunately for us, God does not abandon the things that he's joined themselves to.
Amen.
Right? So if he's made a covenant, God doesn't get out of that covenant unless we do.
That's
he told Abraham, he says, since I can find nobody greater than myself, I swear by myself that I'll bless you.
Yes.
Right? So when God makes a covenant with us, he doesn't get out of that covenant unless we get out of the covenant. So he charges us here, stay in the covenant. Why is the covenant important as we're talking about consuming fire, which I'm going to talk about in a second? Because there are several ways that God reveals his power. Right? One of the ways that God reveals his power primarily is through a covenant.
Yes.
So when we say Jehovah Jireh, right, that's a covenant that God will create provision.
Yes, sir.
If we say Jehovah Rapha, that means that God will create healing, right? So whether that's Matthew 8 and 17, 1 Peter 2 and 24, that's his covenant promise.
Yes.
So if we want to see the power of God released in the church, we must first understand that he is a covenant God. Somebody say covenant God.
Covenant God.
That's why it's so important to be born again. You can sit in the church. Just because you're in McDonald's, it doesn't make you a Big Mac. Because you're in church, it doesn't make you a Christian. You have to have a covenant.
Yes,
so that covenant is important. You have to covenant with God. So the word of God gives us how we make that covenant. Romans 10 and 9. You confess the Lord Jesus. Believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. You shall be saved. That's our covenant. So if you don't have that covenant, you don't have power. If you don't have power, you don't have fire. Right? You're just playing games. Right? So first you got to enter into the covenant. So how else does God demonstrate his power? After his covenant, God would demonstrate his power through his word. Right? So we must have the word of God. So it was so important that we had a foundation scripture for this conference. Sometimes people come together and there is no word. If there is no word, there is no power. If there is no power, there is no covenant. Right? And then God institutes his power through principles and laws. And sometimes the world is smarter than us when it comes to this. So what do I mean? Principles and law. So I'm a born again believer. I love Jesus with all my heart. But if I go stand on the top of this building and jump, there is a law that's going to enact itself on me. It's called gravity.
Yes, sir.
Whether you saved or not.
Yes,
right?
Sir.
So there's laws in the earth realm that we can use God has given us for power. Right? So covenant, right? The word of God. And also we have the principles that undergird God's power. If we are not engaging all three of those things as a church, we will not see the fire of God, because God has invested himself in all three of these elements. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Somebody say, where is my fire? So for my next 12 minutes, I just want to talk about where is my fire? Because I wouldn't come unless somebody needs their fire.
Yes.
Say it again.
Amen.
So we start with this this basic understanding of God. Understanding the character and nature of God is important.
Yeah.
Listen, God gives us something called an ordinance. So please write this down. What's an ordinance? It's a precept or a prescribed way of doing something.
Yeah.
It is a precept or a prescribed way of doing something. We don't have to figure out. We don't have to figure out what we should be doing as believers. We don't have to figure out what God wants us to do. We don't have to figure out what the church wants us to do. We don't have to figure out how to get healing, how to get prosperity.
Amen.
We don't have to figure out how our marriages should be had. We don't have to figure that out.
Amen.
God has what we call an ordinance. It is a prescribed way of doing something. And if the church isn't careful, we can start getting too creative.
Yes.
See, there's some things that we've taken out of church that you shouldn't take out of church. We've got lights and smoke and all of this type of stuff, and we took away sanctification.
Yes, sir.
You take away sanctification, there is no purification.
There's
no purification. There's no transformation. Your mind cannot change. You can do all the hula hoops and jumping jacks that Christians do, but your life will never be changed. You will recycle pain every day of your life. There's just certain things that God has placed in the earth realm that you and I have to abide by if we want to see results. Amen. So I love the word of God. I heard the evangelist talk about this. Jeremiah 6 and 16, just write the scripture down for reference. It says, thus saith the Lord, stand ye in the ways and see and ask for the old paths. Somebody say old paths. Listen to what the word of God says. If you seek the old paths, the Bible says this is the good way. And walk therein and listen to the consequence of doing things the way that God has prescribed. He said, then you shall find rest for your souls. There is a restless church in the earth realm because they conjured up their own way of finding God. Listen, the Bible is true. John 14 and 6. God has prescribed that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. There's no other way that you get to the Father except by him. Now, you can create your own inventions. You can do whatever you want to do, but you'll never find rest for your souls. See, the people of God must understand that there is a prescribed ordinance to God's fire. You don't just come upon the fire just because you're in the house. Just because somebody else has fire and you sitting next to them doesn't mean that you're going to get fired. No, you have to work out your own soul salvation with fear and trembling. You have to apply these principles to your own life.
Hallelujah.
You have to. So Paul says something, or David says something that intrigued me a long time ago, because when I was a young man, I share my testimony all over the place. I grew up homeless most of my childhood, victim of rape and molestation. Both of my parents were heroin addicts. So if there was a bottom of life, I know what it was like.
Yes,
right. So I've been there. That's why I can help people who've been there. I told you I was supposed to be dead. I wasn't saying that in a cute way. I really am supposed to be dead. Amen. And so I identify with David. I identify with David because David did some bad stuff. I heard the evangelist say all the stuff that we get delivered from, right? So I understand that. But David had a way of crawling back to God. But listen, I want you to see something that David said. He says this in Psalm 51, 12, and 13. Listen, because somebody listening to me today, the only reason that you're sitting in this room, because there's been a yearning in your spirit to return back to the former version of yourself. Something's missing. Something's gone. You don't have the passion that you used to have, the fire that you used to have. It ain't there. You're kind of like going through the motions. You love Jesus. You love God, but there is no desire to pray, desire to fast. It's hard to get you to church. It's hard to get you on your knees. And listen, I'm not judging you. I'm just trying to let you know, if you've ever been to a barbecue when you pour water on the coals, all you see is a smoldering ember, but it's not enough to have a cookout. And there's not enough in a lot of these churches to have the cookout.
Wow.
So what God will do is he'll set up a conference like this, and he'll say, get me a few people. He don't need a lot. He don't need a lot. He only say, hey.
Yes.
He'll find a few people and say, listen, I want to put my fire in their belly. I want to wake something up in Shreveport. And the Bible says the last shall be first and the first shall be last. So I know you're looking at everybody on television, but God looking at you. He qualifies the unqualified. Listen to what David says. He says, restore unto me the joy of my salvation. Uphold me with your free spirit. Listen to what happens when God restores fire to the believer. Because when you don't have fire, it's hard to evangelize. When you don't have fire, it's hard to share your testimony because you barely make it. It's hard to share your testimony when you barely make it. And the enemy knows this, right? Because the word of God says we overcome the wicked one by the blood of the Lamb, which you and I have nothing to do with. But the word of your testimony. So if the testimony is not there, then there's no overcoming of the wicked one. Right? So listen to what David says. He said, God, I understand that everything's tied up. Everything's tied up in your spirit being on me. Say, restore to me the joy of my salvation. Uphold me with your free spirit. Now, let me tell you this just to throw this in. Why in the world is David, what is David doing with the Holy Spirit in him? Nobody in the Old Testament had the Holy Ghost.
Come on, man.
When he says, since I got this thing. Listen to what he says. Say, God, please, 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 please don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Listen, he says, because if you do, I won't be able to do the B part of this verse. Right? It says, then will I teach transgressors your ways, and then sinners will be converted. If there is no fire, there is no conversion. There is no fire, there is no evangelism. There is no fire, there is no hope. There is no fire, there is no discipleship. Fire ain't just loud talking.
Amen.
You know when somebody on fire. You get too close, you get burned. You know when somebody's on fire, you start feeling warm just by their conversation. You don't know nobody else to call, but you pick up the phone and call them and say, I don't care what you say, just say something. Because I know whenever you say something, something coming from you.
Glory, glory.
If you never read Psalm 51, I encourage you to do that when you get home. This is a psalm of repentance. That was the psalm that David wrote after he had slept with Bathsheba and killed her husband. That means it doesn't matter what you do in your life, God is able to restore even the adulterer, the killer, the murderer, and the prostitute.
There you go.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
I'm getting ready to take my seat. But listen, let me give you a couple reasons why God will cause his fire to be in the church. Listen, the fire of God never leaves. If the fire of God left, God would have to deny himself. But this is what God does, evangelist. The fire of God, what he will do is he'll look for a people to put his fire on. He'll look for a people to put his fire on. And he'll put fire on the people. And listen, when people are on fire, then they'll begin to witness and win people for God. But all of a sudden, like the Laodicean church, when a person lifts up their head and says, it's by my own power that I've gotten these good things in my life. And God will say, wait a minute. They forgot to give me the glory. I got them the house, the car, the family, the healing, and all of a sudden, they denied my name. And the Holy Ghost will begin to brood over the church and say, wait a minute. God will take that fire. He'll take that fire, but he doesn't quench it. All he does is he brings it back to himself. He'll begin to hide it and look for somebody who's humble enough. There's too much I in the church. I did this. I didn't do anything. It is because of the Lord's mercies me and you are not consumed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. Speak, Lord.
No, you got your education and your degrees.
My Lord.
That's God's mind you use it.
Come on here.
My God.
Come on here.
Amen.
Yeah. I feel that in my spirit to say, because you can be haughty as an American.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Speak. Mm-hmm. My God. So the Holy Ghost, Pastor, the Holy Ghost will brood over your life. They'll say, I'll find somebody who will give me credit. I'll find somebody who understands that when they were in the real wilderness fighting lions and tigers and bears, when they stand before Goliath, they won't say, it's me that's going to take you down to Goliath. No, what they will say is, who is this that dares to defy the armies of the living God? Not my army, not my power, not my strength.
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
My God.
Can I have 5 more minutes,
yes,
Pastor? Five more minutes. I want to give the people of God this. So listen. The fire comes for a reason. God is an orderly God. Some of this stuff we got going on is too chaotic. It's a reason that it's a Garden of Eden and not the jungle of Eden. God does things in order. He doesn't just give you something just because you asked. There has to be kingdom purpose behind it. There has to be an assignment behind it.
My God.
You don't just get it. You don't just get anointing just because you prayed and asked for it. Anointing is not for individuals. Anointing is for the people. If you have no love, no care, no desire to help people, you don't need anointing. So people are praying for things God would never do. He won't give it to you because he loves you enough not to let it kill you. See, if you Moses, you got to be able to stand in the burning bush and not be devoured. The only way you can stand before God's consuming fire and not be devoured is that you got to have purpose with the fire or to kill you. Telling you what I know will kill you. So Moses was able to stand before the burning bush. And the Bible says the bush didn't burn up, nor did Moses die. Why? Because God saw purpose in Moses. Reasons God sends consuming fire. Y'all with me?
Yes, sir.
Let me give you 4 reasons God will send consuming fire. And I'm going to give you 4 things you need to do before you leave here. Because I don't want to give you no information without instruction. That's just hype. But the Bible is hope. Amen. Number one, the reason that God will send consuming fire, because there has to be some spiritual decline.
Spiritual decline.
What do you mean, Pastor? Spiritual decline. That's when people just simply forget God.
Come on, amen.
Listen, this ain't a Christian nation.
No, sir.
No. Don't
it
you be fooled.
It is not.
Look at your government. Yes, look at the laws that are made. This is not a. We got Christians in this nation.
My God. But it's not a Christian nation. No. He's talking to you, man.
But we forgot God.
But God. Yes, sir.
In the beginning was not your job. In the beginning was not your purse, your husband and your wife, your house, your accolades. In the beginning was God.
My God, Jesus.
And so where I'm from, man of God, there's something called abandonment wrath.
Yeah.
It's when God will call people back to himself.
Yes,
he'll call over and over and over and over and over, and people will turn their back on God and say, God, you can have your stuff. You can have your holiness. You can have your sanctification. You can have your laws, your rules. You can have all that.
Yeah,
and the Bible says God will be reaching out with an outstretched arm. But eventually,
come on.
Eventually, he'll withdraw himself.
Yes, sir.
And the Bible says that God will turn away. Pastor, where is that in the Bible? That's the whole Romans chapter 1.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And people will be doing whatever is good in their own eyes. Homosexuality, right? Abortion, right? Men with men, women with women, hitting and killing, murder, taking out our children. All that's right in our own eyes. That lets you know that we're in a state of apostasy.
My God, say that.
And now the pastor has to get up here and say, and I'm telling y'all right now, I ain't scared. The pastor has to get up here and he has to say, well, you know, not trying to pick on anybody. And Pastor Love, you know, I love homosexuals, and it's not all of that. No. That's just like me getting up here and saying, well, you know, I got a, I love adulterers. My best friend's an adulterer. We got adulterers all in the church. No.
My God.
If you call good evil and evil good, we're in a place of apostasy. The fire is coming.
Yes, Lord.
Yes. I'm not coming from heaven. It's coming through you. So God will make you stand up at the committee meeting. He'll make you stand up in the workplace. And all of a sudden it'll be like fire shut up in your bones. And you'll be like, why am I feeling compelled to say something? It's because apostasy is in the place.
Yes, sir. Glory to God.
Spiritual decline.
Jesus.
Number two, spiritual decay.
Spiritual decay.
That's when sin has begun to decompose the believer's life.
Jeez.
What do you mean by decomposition? You've seen flour, you've seen trash, you leave it out long enough, all of a sudden the sun and the elements get to it, and all of a sudden it begins to turn on itself.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That can happen to the life of the believer.
Yes, sir.
Oh, don't you be fooled by what's going on the outside. God looks at the heart.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does.
And you can decompose if you stay in sin too long. Sin has pleasure for a season. No, James describes it this way. He said, sin. He said, lust. Lust, it draws you away. And it begins to entice you. And after sin conceives, it brings forth death.
Yes, sir. That's what it says.
Flirt with it enough. Live with it enough. Play with it enough. It'll begin to decompose your life. That's anybody. Even starting with the man with the microphone. That's why I tell people right now, I've been married 17 years. You flirt with me, I'm going to get up on Sunday morning and tell it. I love my wife.
Amen to that. Come on, man. Come on, man. Amen, preacher.
Come on. Spiritual decay.
My God, my God.
Number three, spiritual failure. Spiritual failure. When there is no longer power evident in the church. No power to heal. No power to save. Empty pews. Empty altars. We lay hands and people know even though we lay hands, they're not going to get healed. It's just a formality. Spiritual failure. You'll sin consuming fire. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So these are the reasons that God will send consuming fire. And so he has to put it in the heart of a man and a woman and say, you don't got all the details. Just put the conference together. Just invite the people. I'll do the rest.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Let me end here before I go somewhere else in the prophetic. All right. So listen.
Hallelujah.
What's our assignment? Please write this down. What's your assignment? Your assignment. I charge our church. I charge this church.
Yes, sir.
Whatever church represented here. Because we are the church.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All right. Please write this down. Our mandate as a generation is to host and to preserve the fire of God. My mandate, let me make it personal so you don't think I'm talking to you. In my generation, David said, I serve my generation. My mandate in my generation is to host and to preserve the fire of God. Never let your fire go out. Pastor, how do I do that? I'm going to give you these ways and I'm going to take my seat. Number one,
Number one, I must make a commitment to the ministry of prayer, intercession, and supplication. I must make a commitment to the ministry of prayer, intercession, supplication. Luke 18:1 says, men ought to always pray and to not faint. In other words, if you ain't praying, you ain't even a human. That's how I know you human. You pray. That's what the scriptures say. I didn't say that. Number one. So the devil knows this, so he's going to ask you when it's time to pray, because I'm telling you, after you leave here, the Holy Ghost is going to unction you to do what I'm releasing here. He's going to unction you to pray. Now the devil has to do his part. He's going to say, wait a minute, you didn't finish the series on Netflix. He's going to have your cousin and your auntie to call you. I don't want that, just wanted to talk. You got to recognize when this is happening. 2 Corinthians 2:11, for we are not ignorant of Satan's devices. So you got to make the commitment. For those of you all who like me, I got to put it in my phone. This is the hour of prayer. This is the time I'm praying. Don't call me. Don't text me. Don't ask me to cook you nothing. None of that. I ain't rubbing your feet. This is the time I'm praying.
Amen.
Somebody say, make a commitment. I'm telling you how you get the fire of God. When you get it and keep it. I'm always going to be on fire, man of God. No matter. I don't care what they do in the city.
Amen.
I know how to keep it. Hallelujah.
Yeah, hallelujah.
All right, number two. If you have not been, please turn back to God. If you have not, turn back to God. I know people say, and I agree, but there is a higher revelation. Yeah. I know we say God is the head of my life. He is.
Yes,
God's the center of my life. He is.
Yes, sir.
But can I submit the fact to you? God is your life.
Amen.
If you don't have God, you're dead.
Come on, you shout out. Glory to God. Amen.
So you may have a priority in your life. Like your money may be your God. Your boo may be your God. Your car may be your God. Turn back to God, or you won't see the fire of God. He said, I am a jealous God. That's what the verse said. I'm a jealous God. Jealousy in this verse is not the same jealousy that we use in America. It's not the same English language. Let me tell you what jealousy is in Hebrew and Greek. Jealousy in Hebrew and Greek means that if you don't join yourself with me, you lose out.
Come on here.
Jealousy in the Hebrew and Greek simply means that if you don't live in me, then you lose out. I don't lose anything. God is not jealous like he's losing anything. God is completing himself. But he understands that if I don't connect to him, I miss out.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So he said, if you want the best, you got to run with the best. Return back to God. All of us know if we place something else on the altar of our heart. You don't need no prophet. You don't need no word of knowledge. All of us know the idols that we have set up on our heart. Some of our idols are NFL packages.
Come on.
Amen.
Amen.
Last but not least, I apologize for going over my time. I don't ever do that. I apologize.
Number three.
I must keep a sacrifice on the altar.
My God.
Hallelujah. I got to keep a sacrifice on the altar. Listen. Leviticus 6 and 13. Take this notation here. Leviticus 6 and 13. I think I'm going to start in verse 12. Y'all with me?
Yeah.
All right, amen. Verse 12. Hallelujah. The Lord showed me this and messed me up. Okay, so this is the Levitical priest responsibility as it pertains to the temple. We are no longer going to the temple. We are the temple of God.
Yes,
all right?
Yes.
So look at verse 12. It says, and the fire. Somebody say fire.
Fire.
Come on, say it like you mean it. Fire.
Fire.
And the fire upon the altar shall be burning in it. Take your hand and lay it on yourself. And burn it in here. It shall not be put out. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor. Say, they ain't going to put my fire. I don't care what they do. Okay, listen to the prescription here. And the priest shall burn wood On it every morning. How am I burning wood on it every morning? Prayer. Fasting. Studying the word. Corporate fellowship. I'm putting wood on the fire.
Jesus. Come on now.
Yes, God.
That's good too.
My God. My God.
Jesus. Jesus.
He says, the priest shall burn wood on it every morning. Your mornings are super special to God. Jesus got up at 6 a.m. David said, early in the morning. Don't roll over and start checking Facebook. No. Say something to the Father first. Then check Facebook. Listen to the scripture. And lay the burnt offering in order upon it. And he shall burn thereon the fat of the peace offerings. Listen, the Bible says that we are living sacrifices. That don't even make sense. How can you be a sacrifice and still be living? That means every day you got to kill yourself on that altar. The word with you, fasting with you, corporate fellowship, study of the word. It'll lay you on the altar and kill everything in you that ain't supposed to be there. Listen, don't be discouraged. Don't be discouraged if all your bad behaviors start coming out when you get close to God's fire. Because listen, if you take fire and you put it on gold, for instance, right? If you take fire and you subject it to gold, what happens is all the gold goes to the bottom, but all the impurities come to the top. So when the Holy Ghost touches you, all your bad behavior and problems and situations and circumstances start rising. You're not evil. You're not demonic. You're not bad. You're just being burnt by the fire. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Glory to God.
So they think something wrong with you. No, you're being purified. God is showing you all the stuff your grandmother done had problems with. Generational curses, outbursts, and all types of stuff that you learned. Childhood trauma. Some of y'all like me been through molestation and rape and abuse. And all that stuff got to come to the surface. And God got to purify. There's nothing wrong with you. He's helping you. So you hiding, listen, let them laugh. You come to the altar, kick off your shoes, get before the Holy Ghost and say, God, whatever I got going on, Lord God, get it out now. They looking at you, laughing at you, but they don't know that you're getting ready to stand before Goliath. And when God get rid of all of them impurities, you're going to stand before the giant. And you're going to say, in the name of the living God, I'll take your hand today, Goliath, and all your family members try to figure out where the hell you come from. They don't know you don't been through the fire. The Holy Ghost has come upon you. I feel something. My family left me for dead. I was the least in my family. You will be just like your daddy. Daddy was a homeowner, hustler, prostitute. Grandfather was a womanizer. All that type of stuff. But I looked at my three boys and said, stop right here. Whatever I got to do to be changed and transformed, I'm willing to pay the price. So every day I get on the altar and kill a little bit of myself. And get back the next day and kill a little bit of myself.
Jesus.
So you become unrecognizable to the human eye, man. But God recognizes you.
Yes,
sir.
Yes.
Shout out to God. I'm in, I promise. I'm getting out. All right. So listen. Verse 12 says, and lay the burnt offering in order upon it. Burn therein the fat of the peace offerings. Listen, when you're doing this, it's an offering unto God. You're not wasting your time. I know all your homegirls and homeboys, they at the club, they laughing, and you know, they kicking and they having fun. It feels like you're missing out. No. This is a sweet smelling offering. This is an investment in your future. Teach your kids that.
Amen.
Oh, no, your prayers. Oh, your meditation. I know your friends are hanging out. But listen, this is a price you pay. In 5 and 10 years, you'll see the difference between you and them.
Yes, sir.
Oh, Esther had a different preparation than the rest of the young women.
Yes, sir.
The three Hebrew boys had a different preparation than the rest of the young men. See, the preparation they needed allowed them to step into the fire and not be burned.
Not be burned.
Jesus.
It's a different preparation.
Woo.
Verse 13 is where I was trying to get. It says, the fire, Pastor T, shall ever be burning upon the altar, and it shall never go out. That's the promise of the Holy Ghost. That's the promise of the Holy Ghost to me and you. Christianity was never meant to be bored. It was never meant to be powerless. But will you make that sacrifice? Hallelujah. Will you pay that price today? The Lord would never call me to go anywhere unless somebody here.
Yes, sir.
This is your predicament.
Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Father.
But the word of the Lord says, your salvation draws nigh. The time is now. There is Chronos time on the clock, and then there's Kairos time, a special time and moment. I'm telling you, this is your Kairos moment. So I pray in the name of Jesus that the Holy Ghost finds you in your seat today. And in the meditation of your heart, you make your own commitment. You don't need me. You got a high priest. You don't need me. Make the decision today. Tomorrow's not promised to any man. Make the decision today. Some of you, God has already been dealing with you. That's the only reason I'm here. He's come to collect on his investment. In the name of Jesus. Listen, I thank you all for listening to me. I thank God what the Holy Ghost is doing in your life. Man of God, woman of God, thank you so much. Pastor, thank you so much. Y'all be blessed. God bless.